Okay, hello everyone, good evening, and welcome to the 15th session of the online Optom learning series. Today we have Optom Mumtaz Qazi. She is a graduate from the Lotus College of Optometry India, as well as she has pursued her master's from the Lotus College. She is now still associated with Lotus College as an associate professor. And today she is going to talk to us about the basics of progressive additional lenses. Please put your hands together for her and welcome her to deliver her session.
Good evening, everyone. So myself, Mumtaz Qazi, as Fakhruddin has already introduced me, I am currently working as an assistant professor in Lotus College of Optometry, Mumbai, India. So before, we are going to deal with the progressive addition lenses. So before I will start with the basic of progressive, let's see how this progressive has arrived. So as you all know, progressive, we normally give it to the patient who are having presbyopia. So presbyopia is related to the age. And the American singer, Miss Erpicket, has rightly said, aging has a wonderful beauty. And we should have a respect for that. So similar way, we should respect our each and every patient, and we should deal with them in proper way, in whatever best we can do for them. So before I'll go in the progressive in detail, just to let you know about the basic of presbyopia. So the presbyopia is due to the aging. It's an aging concept. With age, the crystalline lens loses its elasticity or its flexibility, and it becomes more and more hardened, the sclerosis of the crystalline lens. And because of that, the amplitude of accommodation decreases, and hence your near point distance will recede. And the person who is the age of like 35, 40 years, he or she will have difficulty in seeing the near object clearly at his normal working distance, which you normally consider 33 centimeter. So now they have a problem. So what kind of symptoms you can assume from the patient? That they will have eye strain or headache post doing the near work, difficulty reading the small print. There will be some kind of eye fatigue when focusing on the near object. They will require more amount of light to read. And then they have trouble focusing in the object which are close by. And there are some patients who can do squinting, like they will squeeze their eyes and see the near object. Of course, if there is a problem, that there should be some kind of management. So since ages, we have many more kind of management for these patients. Like you can give them single vision glasses in the form of either reading glasses or either in the form of one for distance, one for near, separate glasses for distance and near. Either we can give them bifocals, trifocals, but they have their own limitation and disadvantage. Then if we come to the contact lenses also evolving in terms of presbyope and multifocals. So we have different, either we can give them distance contact lenses, and then we can give them, try to give them reading glasses for near. Either we can try for monovision, modified monovision, multifocal. We have various options available. And in the form of surgery also, nowadays people do clear lens extraction. Like we call it as presbyopic LASIK. But here, the foremost important, as the stats say, is still the progressive addition lenses. So let's start with progressive addition lenses then. So as you can see the stats, by 2015, it is estimated that 2.1 billion of the people in the world are affected by presbyopia. And it is expected to increase as the population is increasing. It is going to increase to approximately 3 billion. And if you see only in Asia, then 1 in 2 people age 45 and above, but they don't have proper vision correction what they need. So as a part of the optometrist, we have to deal with all these things, and we have to provide them the good amount of correction, whatever is best suitable for them are available. So if you go in the history of progressive, the phenomena was first patented in the year 1907, but the first progressive has arrived in the year 1959 by Essilor. And if you see the basic design of progressive, this is a basic reference point of progressive, it's progressive. And this is a very basic thing. In a worldwide acceptance, a most suitable correction for presbyopia, because they provide the clear, comfortable and natural vision at all distances, whether it is distance, near, intermediate, at any distance you can say. And they have gradually replaced bifocal lenses. And they are becoming more and more in demand. Like if you see 25% fitted with progressive addition lenses, less than 25% with bifocal lenses, and around 50% with single vision lenses. It depends on country to country. This ratio can vary. But the only thing is the PALS is in demand. So we have to make sure we should know each and every part, at least the basic of PALS. That's why we are here to discuss it, the basic of PALS. So in progressive lens power, there is, if you see the distance to near, there is an increment of power, there is a change of curvature, increase in power obtained by continuous change in curvature from one or both the surfaces. If you compare this progressive design with either with bifocal or either with single vision. So if you see a single vision, there is only one option. Like either patient, you can give them only distance correction, only intermediate correction, or only near correction. The patient, the near task of the patient get limited, the visual field get limited. But and if you deal with bifocal, you can either correct for distance, either correct for near. But in progressive, you can give a patient, you can try to connect your patient for every distance. It starts from your distance reference circle to your intermediate zone to your near vision zone. So that is the biggest advantage of progressive. So there is a continuous vision from distance to near, comfortable vision for all intermediate distance, like whatever distance come between 50 centimeter to 1.5 meter. Suppose if I give you example, if you're having a presbyopia, presbyopia patient whose addition is like they are little early presbyope, like addition is almost less than or equal to 1.5 diopter of ED, they will still obtain clear vision and intermediate distance because of remaining amount of accommodation. But this will not be the same case for the later stages of presbyopia when the addition is more than 2 diopter. So in that case, they will require some kind of power to see the near object because the remaining amplitude of accommodation is not going to help them. So in that case, there is the option of progressive for them. Similarly, there is a continuous support for accommodation in progressive addition lenses. The eye can find some region of the progression zone where the power is correct for the viewing distance with a bifocal lens. And I can increase or decrease the accommodation as it passes through the intermediate zone. So we can see at each and every point, we can see clearly. And there is something called as continuous space perception. As we are gradually coming from distance to near, near to distance, then we can just go through the full space. Not like bifocal where there is a presence of image jump, or not trifocals. But as people say, if there is an advantage to manage of disadvantage, then there should be some limitation. I won't say disadvantage of progressive, but there are some limitation of progressive which we are trying to overcome in the recent development. So the basic limitation of progressive is the peripheral aberration, or you can say the optical aberration which is present at the periphery. And why does it happen? Because as the power changes from distance to near, because of the laws of physics and everything, there are tend to have the periphery will have the cylindrical power, the periphery unwanted cylindrical lenses. And if you all know, there is something called as Minkowitz theorem, where they say the increment of the power from the top to the bottom of the lens induces an unwanted astigmatism in the lateral areas of the lens. Similarly, the older generation of progressive will have some kind of adaptation problem. Cost, of course, is a very important point, because if you compare the cost with single vision or bifocal lenses, they are little expensive and it requires a more chair time. more chair time, I will say, because it requires you have to give your patient a proper, you have to take before dispensing the progressive to any presbyope. You have to take proper measurement, because if you don't take proper measurement, then there are chances you are not able, maybe you will give them best design, but if you don't give check the proper measurement before giving it to the progressive, then you are not going to dispense it properly. So as I've gone through the SLR Academy PDF, and I found out that there are, in when the progressive was trying to build up its coming to the contact, it's fine that there are so many generations which they have come. The progressive design have evolved so much. It starts from the Verilux 1 to Verilux 2. Now we have Physio 360. Now we have SLR X series. Then there are so many generations which are available in progressive design. So if you see the progressive, the basic design of progressive, the first generation progressive, if you can see here, okay, they were having only a simple, the spherical surfaces in the upper half of the lens, and there was a near zone linked together. And the original type of progressive, they all were having a symmetric design. So what do you understand by symmetric design? The symmetric design means that when patient, the both eye lens, the right eye and the left eye lens, they used to design with the same design, and there was no difference. If somebody wants to fit the lenses in the right eye, then they have to rotate it 10 degrees towards the nasal size. If they want to fit in the left eye, they have to rotate the lens 10 degrees. So this was not comfortable, because patient was not comfortable with this. Then they have come up with a design called asymmetric design, where there was a difference between the right and the left lens. If you can see this line, which we normally call it, this is the umbilical line, which joins the distance to the near portion. If you can see here, it's a very straight line, where they are rotating it to fit into the right and the left eye. But if you see the asymmetric design, they are designed specially for the right eye and specially for the left eye. So there will be no confusion, and patient can get a good field of vision. Then in your next generation, they were trying. If you can see in the previous slides also, there are too much of aberrations and everything was present at the periphery. So in optical modulation, they were trying to reduce this aberration by doing something called as orthoscopy, where they were thinking the straight line which patient sees through the periphery of the lens, they should see it much and more straight and more clearly. The example for that is Verilux 2, which was invented in 1972. Now the main thing, the main generation, the main evolution has come in the third generation of progressive design, where they have come up with a different design for progressive, like hard design, soft design, the mono and multi design. So because initially it was realized that if the same power law was used for each different near addition, it did not result in the optimum progressive surface for each stage of presbyopia, because we required a different addition, we require different design. As you can see, the early presbyope requires soft progressive surface to enable them to adapt quickly, whereas late presbyope prefer hard design to provide larger field of view. So, but initially all PALs have the low single design for all powers, hence monovision limited in its effectiveness. Hence we have come up with something called as multi design, where as the ad changes, the design will also change. And what do you understand by this hard design and soft design? So you can see in the image, the hard design, the distance and the near area is wider, but if you compare it with soft design, the distance and the near area is little narrower than the hard design. But if you compare the intermediate zone in these two, intermediate zone in hard design is little narrower, and intermediate zone in the soft design is wider. And because of this, there is a it requires a longer adaptation, and it requires a shorter adaptation, because it's a short corridor, you can say short corridor or lens corridor, which we are normally using it right now. So there are various examples available, various multi-design like American Optical, Omni Pro or Hoya is giving you Hoya Lux. Then we come up with something called as natural vision, where it says okay, the observation arise when the patient was having different habit when wearing their pulse. The basic concept was to shorten the length of the progression zone of the lens in order to offer wearers more comfortable posture for near vision, and at the same time to control the deformation in the periphery. It means okay, we have to now combine the advantages of hard design and the soft design, so that the patient should get a better version design of the progressive. The requirement was to try to combine in a single design the two characteristics of a short progression and short periphery. If we give you an example, suppose if somebody is having addition of plus 2, so if you are giving them a normal design, then the plus 2 add, they will get it at the lens periphery. But if you give them a shorter corridor design, like a hard design, that 85% of the full addition they will get at just 12 mm of the fitting height, instead of like normally we used to get it at 15 mm or 70 mm below the fitting cross, but now we can get it at the 12 mm, so that the patient get more and wider area for near vision. So example, if you can see the example is Perilux Comfort or Autograph and anything. The fifth generation which we have come up is to make sure the patient should get a wider field of view. Wider field of view we will get when we will try and reduce the peripheral aberration or the peripheral cylindrical. So if you look the young presbyope, they require quick and easy adaptation, and experience require a wider field of view. So in peripheral region, reduction of distortion by controlling the distribution of prismatic effect on the surface of the lens. So there are so many still available, Hoyalux ID and Verilux Ellipse and everything. And the last and the foremost thing, the sixth generation which we are dealing with, like, they all are like high resolution, personalized progressive, digitally progressive, which we are dealing with right now. We will go in detail about them in the next slides. But I hope this basic design, like how, if you can see here, how the basic design of progressive have evolved so much in so many years. So before going into the recent design and the troubleshooting and everything, we'll go back to a basic, and we'll just see before you are going to dispense your progressive design, what are fitting measurement you have to take. The four most important thing to measure is the monocular distance IPDs, which you can use it by, measure it by anything. You can use it either your IPD ruler, you can use it your pupillometer, anything you can use it, and you can measure this monocular distance PD. Then you have to make sure your frame is, before marking the corneal reflex on the frame, you have to make sure the frame is properly aligned. Okay, this all factors come in the pentascopic tilt, the frame height, the vertex distance. So quickly I'll show you one video where you will get much nice idea how to deal with this.
We must choose frames with appropriate shape for progressive lenses. Frame depth is also important. If it's too shallow, the viewing area may be insufficient. The minimum recommended frame depth is 22 mm below and 12 mm above the pupil center. This frame is too shallow. The depth of this frame is more suitable for progressive lenses, but it's best to check it on eye, as frames sit differently on different people. Here, there is sufficient depth below the pupil center. Choose a frame shape that covers the inferior nasal area sufficiently. Aviator shapes such as this are not ideal because much of the reading area will be cut away. It's essential to adjust the frame prior to marking up for fitting height. First, adjust the length of the temple approximately so that the frame will not slide down. Check the approximate amount of temple length adjustment required. To adjust the temple length, the temple is first heated and then bent by hand to increase or decrease the distance between the frame front and the bend. Other frame adjustments that follow will also affect the distance between the front of the frame and the ear. Temple length will require final adjustment later. The frame must also be level on the wearer's face. The level of the frame can be changed by adjusting the angle of the temple. The temple on the side that's sitting low should be lowered by bending from the eye wire trim using an appropriate tool. The frame is now level on the wearer's face. Facial wrap is a slight curving of the frame to follow the alignment of the face. Facial wrap increases the viewing area through the near and intermediate zones. This frame is sitting too flat on his face. To improve or increase facial wrap, gently bend the frame. Be careful not to twist it or apply pressure unevenly. Now the frame follows the line of the wearer's face. Next, minimize the vertex distance, which is the distance between the lens and the eye. A small vertex distance increases the viewing area through the lens. Minimize it, but avoid the lens touching the eyelashes. One way of achieving this is by holding the nose pad with special pliers and bringing it closer to the frame. Adjust both nose pads. You can see here that the vertex distance is significantly reduced. Panoscopic tilt is the angle between the frame front and an imaginary vertical line. The targeted angle is 10 to 15 degrees. This frame does not have sufficient tilt. The panoscopic tilt can be increased by bending the temples down. Hold the front of the frame with your hand. Grasp the eye wire trim and bend it down slightly. Do the same with the other side and check that the frame level has not been affected. Now the frame has good panoscopic tilt. The frame is now ready for the fine adjustment of the temple length. Check the temple length and if necessary, adjust further. With the frame properly adjusted for the wearer, we can now proceed to marking up.
So I hope this has cleared most of your doubts and everything, how to take the measurement down, how to adjust the frame. Before taking any amount of measurement, you have to first adjust your frame properly so that you could able to take a proper measurement. Because if you don't do it properly, then there will be chances the patient is not getting adapt, which we will discuss in the troubleshooting part. So after taking all your measurements and everything on your frame, you have to see how much amount of fitting height you're getting for this particular type of frame. Or else you have to, one thing you have to make sure, okay, whatever design, see, every manufacturer will give you a different layout card for their particular brand or for their particular design. So you have to, especially if you have decided okay, this particular design you are going to give it to your patient, then please try to use that only layout card. Try to see how much amount of fitting height you are getting and whether the near circle is exactly coming inside the frame or not. See, in the case of supra frame or in the case of frameless frame, if you find your near circle getting cut, anytime you can increase the height from the down, but that won't be the case in the case of full frame. So you have to select your design very accurately. But now we have evolved so much in the progressive design so that we can try to, as they said, the aviator type frames are not ideal for progressive. But now the designs are available, which you can give it to any type of frames. You cannot limit your patient, okay, don't use this type of frame, you cannot use it. You can use it. You can give them freedom of choice of frame. Okay, they can select any type of frame and you can go ahead. So pre-delivery, before giving it to your patient, you have to identify the micro-edging, which is there at this side. Check the distance power and the near power with the help of your lensometer. Check the fitting height, whether it is proper, and then check the monocular PDs. Okay, whatever you have asked for and it is proper or no. And then when the patient will arrive to your clinic, at that time, you have to do some type of on-eye verification, like you have to check for fitting cross, you have to make sure your patient is wearing the spectacle properly, and then you have to check the fitting cross position, patient vision, distance and near. You have to give them little bit amount of training, the adaptation technique and everything, and then at the later on when the patient is comfortable, you can remove the temporary marking. But suppose after a few days, patient is coming back to you and saying, yes, I'm not comfortable with this lens and I'm not comfortable with this. Then you have to direct, you don't delay. See, progressive, ideally progressive will take at least 15 to 21 days of adaptation thing. The newer design will take less also, 3 to 4 days or minimum 10 days. But you have to give them little adaptation time. And if suddenly next day patient is coming and telling you, yes, I'm not getting comfortable, then of course you have to give them adaptation time. But post that also, if patient is not comfortable, then you have to try to solve their problem. So as the source of error can lie in the height, the pupillary distance, or else you have swept the lenses like from right to left or left to right, or else there is wrong power. Like every time, don't directly jump. If patient is complaining, if she or he can't see for distance or near, don't directly jump, yes, maybe my refraction is wrong. Refraction is the last part you should consider. But before that, you have to consider all these things. So let's see some of the example. So suppose the patient is saying they are seeing blurry distance vision. So what could be the reason for blurry distance vision? So either the fitting height is too high, fitting cross, or else there is an incorrect refraction. So how you can correct that if the fitting height is too high? You have to first make sure that you have to bring the fitting height a little low. Then how you can loosen the nose pad, or you can open the nose pad so that fitting height will come low. And if you found out the incorrect lens refraction is there, then you have to remake the lenses. The next is, if patient is complaining, she or she is saying blurry vernier. So what could be the reason for that? Either the fitting height is too low, the patient is trying to see from the intermediate zone or from the distant zone, or inadequate pentascopic tilt, or it could be a reason of incorrect refraction. So how you can deal it? You have to tighten your nose pad. You have to bring in the nose pad. You have to do, if there is difficulty in the pentascopic tilt, then you have to do the frame adjustment, and either or you have to remake the lenses if there is an incorrect refraction. Then patient is complaining of the swimmy sensation, like he or she is finding it difficult to climb down or climb up the stairs. Then there are chances there is incorrect PD or height, inadequate pentascopic tilt. There will be a problem of facial wrap or adaptation issues. Then you can treat this patient by just increasing the facial wrap or increase the pentascopic tilt. Like if patient is feeling reading area is too small, he or she is getting, he has to exactly look at the margin of the frame, lower margin of the frame, and then only he can see. Then in that case, there are chances possible cause will be incorrect PD. And there is some issue with the fitting height. So you have to do the frame adjustment, or else you have to refit the lenses. Just a minute. Suppose the patient is having to look at the side to read. So in that case, the possible cause will be incorrect PD, or there are chances of patient has swept the lenses, or else while fitting, we have swept the lenses for the right or the left. So you can refit the lens with the correct PD and swap lenses if frame is of symmetrical shape. Then the next problem is, suppose the patient is having to tilt the head too far back to read. So in that case, you can, possible cause may be incorrect PD. Maybe your ad is too weak, hence the patient has to find the exact position where he can see the clear object and the changed design. So what you can do, you can bring in the nose pad if you think it can help, and increase the ad or refit with the new lenses. Then patient has to tilt the head backward for distance. Then what could be the cause? The cause may be there is uncorrected hyperope or overcorrected myope. And for that, you can repeat the refraction or refit the lenses. Or else having to tilt the head forward to read. Now maybe ad is too strong, hence patient is trying to find out the lower ad position and then he can try to see. So again, you have to repeat the refraction and refit the lenses. And having to tilt head forward for distance. So it may be fitting height is too high. So you can do the frame adjustment, you can increase, and or else you can refit the lenses. So this all I have gone through the book Borish, okay, where I have found out all the kind of troubleshooting cases. You also can go through that. You will get a much better idea. So I hope this is clear with your basic designs of progressive, how to fit the progressive lenses, the recent, the troubleshooting cases, how you are going to handle it. Each and every patient is different. But nowadays we can overcome because nowadays so much of designs are available, personalized design, the digital design in which patient is able to see, get adapt with these lenses as early as possible. The basic idea is to provide each presbyo with the same vision, like they are getting best vision from the progressive lenses. There are so many technologies which are available from different companies. Like people lifestyle and aspiration are constantly changing. With technology, inflammation plays a very important role in correction, protection, and enhancing the vision. And all the presbyo which are there today are Generation X. Like they are in the age of born in the age of like 1965 to 1980. They are highly active, digitally connected, and don't want to be limited by their vision. So we are doing extensive research and effort so that we can come up with the progressive lenses by concentrating on increasing the binocular performance of individual lens design, like considering their online lifestyle, like sharp, clear, and comfortable vision we should provide them. So for that, there are so many recent advancement which is going on in the. So I have just written here the basic of the digital progressive, what all techniques are available in the progressive lens design. So there are different technology which is copyrighted by different company like Essilor, Hoya, Nikon, and everything. There is something called as path optimizer technology, where they are dealing with a patient should set a precise and optimal viewing path from far to near and everything which is coming in between. And each and every path matches the wearer eyesight and it fits in any type of frame. So now the whatever new form of progressive lenses are available, you can fit them in any form of frame. There is nothing like you cannot fit them in this frame or that frame. There are something as Verilux Comfort. Then we have something called as Precio Digital and WN, which all by Nikon itself, which says they all are using an aberration filter in between. They are dual surface progressive, like they provide wider intermediate vision for fast adaptation and clear aberration filter. And they provide us the natural vision. So they all are using the digital technologies and everything so that they can make it progressive more and more comfortable for your patient. Then there is something called a digital insight technology by Zeiss. Where they are trying to make the lenses more and more used for the digital thing, because nowadays we are mainly dealing with your laptop, mobile, tablet and everything. So hence you can use that. It's like Precision Pure or Precision Plus, where you can put the same lenses in the any type of frame or any type of glasses. And they basically what they do now, sometimes suppose patient is the older wearer of progressive lenses. So what they do, they find out they have some kind of eye tracer machine, they kind of frame tracer machine, where they find out what type of frame they are using it initially. And then they put the same data, like every company has their own data color, like Hoya is having Hoya iLog. There is having iTracer and everything. So you can use any type of devices to make your progressive dispensing more and more easy and comfortable for your patient. In Hoya, we have view expansion technologies and everything. And if you go to something known as your personalized progressive, which is there in the demand now, everyone is asking for personalized progressive, where they change the thing. The basic idea is to provide each player with the same vision, like they obtain from a normal lenses, or they can get. Like personally, we try to grab the information from the patient as much as possible about their lifestyle, about their habits and everything, and we trying to make them a proper lens for them. So in, if you see these type of technologies which are available by Essilor, it's like synchronized or wavefront advanced, like PIF technology, which is in the highest demand right now, which provides sharp distance at any distance. There are something called as 4D technology, like four dimension, and there is something called nano optics, so that you won't get the swim effect or anything. So if you compare this design with the normal, then these are the conventional progressive which you are using. Is your reading area is little less, your distance is less. But if you just compare with the now today's personalized progressive, then you will get a wider area for distance as well as near, as well as for intermediate, and there will be minimum distortions. Then there is something called as binocular harmonization technology by Hoya, where if you just see the difference. If you've seen in the video, there are the both the images in the right and the left eye were slightly different. So different prescription in the right eye length lenses, which lead to binocular disharmony and resulting in visual disbalance that may cause eye strain while wearing standard progressive lenses. Then hence Hoya has come up with this technology called binocular harmonization technology, where they recalculate and adjust the progressive power distribution according to the actual use position on each lens, so that both eyes will experience the same accommodation support. Apart from that, there are adaptive technology, there are 3D vision, face fit technology by Zayas, and there's something called individual fit and luminance design. So luminance design and individual fit, again, it is by, we can say it is by Zayas only, and they say, like somebody has asked me a question related to pupil size. So they can, this design will help them for the luminance design, which basically depend upon your pupillary distance, like pupillary size. And then they come up with the lens which will fit to their patient properly. So there are various examples of personalized progressive. Okay, that's it from my end.
Thank you very much, Mumtaz, for briefing us about the very basic knowledge about progressive lenses and letting us know what are the new advances happening and informing us about the designs and the various technologies. There are a couple of questions. I think you answered one of it. The first question was, if some patient have larger pupil size permanently than normal patients, then which progressive lenses would suit them? Do they still can wear progressive lenses, and what lenses will suit them? So I think you answered that question, that the Zayas lens would suit them. But yeah, the other question is, normally in an optical store, we know progressive lenses by regular and short designs. We really don't know what is hard and soft design. So how do we know about it? Do you have any idea?
So in a, see, normally the short corridor, long corridor, the ultra short corridor, they all are coming in the like advanced soft design, or you can say the short like the basic thing between the difference between the hard design and the soft design is, like, the hard design will have a faster adaptation, like the steps which the progressive power changes from distance to near, they are little faster as compared to the soft design. So So I think so, it will be almost same, but I have not particularly known about this, like whether the long short corridor known as heart design or anything else.
I think it's also based on the brand. Some brands or some designs only give you a hard design, whereas others give you a soft design in different corridors. So I think you need to have a you need to have a brand knowledge for it. Other than that, I don't think there's any way to determine whether it's a hard or a soft design. You need to know what brand the lens belongs to and what's the design the lens is by looking at the logo engraving onto the lens. Can you guide on corridor selection? What kind of observations should be done while selecting a corridor for the patient?
So corridor of the patient, you can design the four most important thing. It depends upon your frame. Whatever frame you are going to decide for your patient, that will affect your corridor size. And the next thing, as I said in my presentation, like the like if you see the older population, like of presbyope, who are ready, they want a wider field of view. Basically, they are already adapt to the condition. Like, of course, they are using it progressive. They know how to adapt the with the condition of progressive addition lenses. But to make sure that they will get a wider field of view, then it depends upon their lifestyle, their demand, their habits, and then we can decide about the corridor. But for me, I think so, it is basically depend upon your frame selection and the patient requirement.
Yeah, so there is three important things. I think two out of it is what you covered. One is the patient requirement. So we need to understand the patient's needs. What is he going to use for? Is he going to use more of a computer distance, or is it more of a reading distance, or is it more of a distance, you know? So knowing the patient's task is definitely very, very important. The second one is the frame size. That also gives you a guide on the type of the corridor. And the third one is if the patient is already a progressive wearer, so you must know what the patient is already wearing. So changing without having any problem is again a bit of a dicey situation where you will end up into trouble. So those are the three things what you rightly mentioned, I guess. And the other question is, this is a very technical in terms of refraction part, but it's important, I guess. When it comes to near addition, in books, normally people say you must refract monocularly. But in clinical practice, we have seen that addition is calculated based on binocular refraction. What do you think is the most effective method? You should do it monocularly or binocularly?
Of course, if I go by the book or if you saw the clinical practice, once you, if you know the refraction rule, you have to do always monocularly and then binocularly. So first you have to see the monocular eye for every each eye differently, like right eye and the left eye, and then you have to show them. It's not like that. Okay, if you're doing the monocular addition, you're not showing them the binocular. At the end, you have to show them the binocular field, okay, how they are going to see with the both eyes, and then they will easily tell you, because there is nothing called as binocular balancing for near. But for that, you have to do binocular balancing properly for distance, and then you have to come. But before monocular, first do monocular addition for each and eye differently, and then do the binocular addition.
Yeah, I think I quite agree. You should do a monocular add and then look for the binocularity once you open up both the eyes and see whether the range is and everything is maintained. And probably then you can fine tune it if that is necessary. But most of the time, you should start with a monocular addition in terms of clinical practice. Is there any selection of progressive lenses when it comes to asymmetric PD? If the patient have asymmetric PD, is there any difference in selecting any lenses?
So there are designs available. It doesn't matter, like for asymmetric PD, how to select the PAL design. You can, of course, you know, the monocular PDs are different for each and every eye. You can, in nowadays, so you can give progressive for squint patient also, whether they are having XT, ET, anything. Whatever monocular PDs you will tell your manufacturer, they will mail according to that and they will give it to you. Yeah. So in every design, it is.
Yeah, it's all possible. Just that when it comes to edging the lens, you edge specific to the PD, what is there. So as you said, tropia, phoria patients also can be prescribed. Just have to make sure that the monocular PDs are aligned with the fitting cross of the lens.
Then when the lens come, you have to check that whether it has come properly or not before going to glaze it or dispense it to your patient.
Yeah, that's right. And is there any relation between head posture and progressive marking?
Yes, of course. Head posture and progressive marking.
Yeah.
You have to make sure patient is going, whenever you're going to use it, like whenever you're taking up progressive marking, you have to make sure the patient is sitting in their normal primary position, comfortable position, because a little bit change in the progressive marking, like suppose monocular PD, if there is a head posture, then you tend to end up marking the wrong frame PDs. You have to, and then your old progressive design will go on a toss.
So make sure that, you know, the patient is using the progressive lens properly. And also when you, you know, after you mark, you probably give the patient to wear the frame again, so you know how the patient is going to use it on the face, and you can verify whether the markings are correct on his habitual way of using. So that's very important. I mean, head posture definitely is important, but make sure that the markings are done based on the patient's required head posture. If the patient has a particular head posture, you will have to actually inform that, you know, if you have this head posture, we are going to take markings on this particular head posture. And if you do a different head posture, probably the lens's power won't work well. So informing the patient is definitely important. Let's take one or two more questions. I think, what is the prism reference point and is it important?
Yes, of course, prism reference point is very much important. As you all know, during the manufacturing of progressive lens, there is something called as prism thinning phenomena.
Yeah.
So why we are using that prism thinning phenomena? Okay, so if you can see, okay, as a result of increasing curvature of, like, you are increasing the curvature from distance to near. So progressive lens is thinner at the bottom edge than at the top edge. So you will get to see, I can't draw right now, but you can just imagine that the upper portion is thicker and the lower portion is thinner. And for that reason, we induce a base down prism. Okay, its value is, prism diameter is generally 2/3 of the value of addition. And it can be measured at the geometrical center of the lens. And then thinning prism, you have to, like, basically with the prism reference point, till where only, as far as I know, it is prism thinning, we can do it till that point only, so that you won't get a prismatic effect or anything. Am I correct, Fakhruddin?
Yes, okay. Yes, that's right. So prism reference point is the amount of prism thinning which is required, and it helps to calculate as per the formula what you have mentioned. So it's quite important because there is different power generation happening, so there will be some amount of base down prism which has been induced. So it's definitely important, and probably the best way to measure it is using the focimeter. You can actually use the focimeter and measure how much amount of prism is present at the prism reference point by seeing the deflection in the Myers. Calculation sometimes may not be very accurate because it also depends on a lot of things like the power and how the design of the lens is, but measuring on a focimeter will give you an accurate idea. That's my personal opinion on that. One last question before we leave for today. How to convince the patient about changing the corridor based on their work? Is there anything, any tips on how we can convince the patients on changing the corridor?
See, as far as my experience and everything, you don't have to convince your patient, but the patient will tell you, okay, see, because of the today's trends and the digital life and everything, they will come up and tell you, okay, see, my lifestyle is this, my habit is this, and then I want a best lens for me, because now everybody uses Google, everybody uses everything, and they are better knowing of the. And you have to tell them, like, if they are going to, like, corridor, if there is a difference in the design, you have to explain the basic, the benefit. Like, if you see, if you want to digitally personalize progressive, you have to convince to go for the personalized progressive. If your patient is vigorous use of digital design, digital devices and everything. So you have to explain their benefits, and you have to explain the technology behind that. You have to explain the what kind of benefits they will get from the particular design, and mostly the patient will get used to it. Like if I tell you the basic thing, there are different lens available. So you have to eliminate. So the nowadays the basic pinpoint of your patient is digital devices, and you have to deal with the digital eye strain and everything. The patient wants something where they can get some kind of lenses where they will give us the natural vision at the same time, the wider field of view, and at the same time less strain when they are using any type of lenses or any type of digital devices. So the only thing is, the only point is how you put in front of the patient what is the benefit, what are the advantage. Maybe patient will understand that because of the lifestyle and everything issue.
Yeah, true. I think it's good to explain to them, different options, and you can relate that different options to their particular lifestyle. So that's very important in terms of explaining and emphasizing this to your patient that this particular design, this is the zone, and this is how you will see with the short corridor. And because your requirement is more of a computer use, because you know this from the history taking on the use of progressive lenses, and you can suggest why don't you try a larger corridor because the intermediate zone is larger. And I think explaining to the patient and letting them know is the key, because they need to know what you're going to give them. Whether you want to give them a high-end product or even the basic product, they should know what they are wearing and why you are giving them that product. So explanation is very, very important, and that's the key to your successful dispensing, I guess. Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah, so as I was saying, there are different designs available where they take the measurement of frame from the patient, like older frame measurement they take, and they put it in their system or their software, and they try to match the same kind of design. Maybe patient has selected a new frame now, but they can get the same kind of design what they used to wear earlier, and then patient, the adaptation time will be lesser in that case.
Yes. Yeah, true. Now, because of the advancement, you can have that is even more personalized progressive. So making a lens of the similar design and everything what the patient is already wearing. So just by changing the frame, he can have the same exact design in the new frame, so that the adaptation becomes a bit more faster. That's right. Yeah, thank you very much for sharing with us about progressive lenses and about everything what we have discussed today, including the question and answer session. Thank you, Mumtaz, for giving us your time. So today we discussed about presbyopia and progressive lenses. Tomorrow we'll discuss the same thing, but we are going to move into contact lenses. So we have Ms. Tia Joyang. She is a practitioner from Malaysia, and she is going to discuss with us about multifocal contact lenses, insights, updates, and practical applications. So tune in tomorrow, 11 a.m. India time and 1:30 p.m. Malaysia time. Until then, be home, be safe, and see you all again tomorrow. Okay, bye.